friend. All right, thanks. Pick it away, lovely Judy.
Are we going?
We're going.
Okay, I better turn this on. Can you hear me?
Yay.
And can you all hear me that are online? Good morning online and good morning everyone here.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So why don't we begin with this prayer together? I'm so used to my own little thing that I've been touching that instead of that. Okay, this is so much easier than mine. So if you want to pray along with me, this Quaker thought for our times. Do not be dismayed by the brokenness of the world. All things break, and all things can be mended, not with time, as they say, but with intention. So go, love intentionally, extravagantly, unconditionally. The broken world waits for the light that is you. Amen. I'm so glad that we're gathered here this morning to talk about a woman who is a little bit closer to our own day and age than, say, the mystics were, for example. Dorothy Day, who was the co-founder of the Catholic Worker newspaper and the Houses of Hospitality, was born just about a year and a half before my own father, and just about 4 years to the day before my mother. So she is a little bit closer to our own time. The question for us, as it was for Dorothy Day, it seems, is through what lens do we see the world? Through what lens does my life unfold? Just as Dorothy could look back on her life to understand what key moments of grace led her to the life she ultimately lived and acted within the Catholic Church and the Catholic Worker Movement for 50 years, so too can we look back on our lives to consider moments of grace that led us to our vocations and the way that we're living our life today. Is that, what am I doing? Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. So as I was preparing my thoughts on Dorothy Day, I was struck by some words from Andy Barnett, who used to be a priest at the Washington National Cathedral. And he said, "Our triune God is a sending presence, deeply committed to relationship, which requires justice and compassion. One of the central things to know about Trinity is that God sends. God sends forth the act of creation in a primal blur. God so loves the world that God sends Jesus, who then sends the Holy Spirit, the activity of God in our midst. The Holy Spirit builds and sends God's church. And God's church sends us, you and me, into the troubled waters where the kingdom is not. It is precisely in these waters that God calls us to build the kingdom of shalom, which is a just peace for all of God's children. This is nothing short of the apostolic mission of God." And Karl Barth, who was a minister, his dictum was, "Carry the Bible in one hand and carry the Bible in one hand and the newspaper in the other." So you have Bible and newspaper, church and in being in the world, and heaven and the kingdom here on earth. We are all sent. So today, let's look at Dorothy Day's journey of being sent in terms of the Bible and the newspaper, the church and the world, and heaven and earth. 86 years ago, on May Day in 1933, the first issue of the tabloid newspaper, The Catholic Worker, was published and sold on the streets. Should I just take this off? Because I keep... Huh? Okay. Oh, okay. Can all of you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Is it fluttering for you all when I'm talking?
It sounds fine.
Okay.
It was echoing
for. Oh, it's not?
No.
Oh, okay. Well, no, I thought it was driving you all nuts. So here we go. So if it's not driving you nuts, I'll wear it. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Okay. So anyway, they were selling this newspaper at a workers' rally in New York City on Union Square for a penny a copy. And to this day, the Catholic Worker is still sold at a penny a copy. 1933, as you may be aware, was a very dire year in the Great Depression. And it was also part of the first 100 days of FDR's first administration. This May Day, where millions were really out of work, banks were collapsing, homes were repossessed, and Hooverville sprang up like dandelions in a field or kudzu in the South. But a first edition editorial stated that the Catholic Worker was published for those who are huddling in shelters trying to escape the rain, for those who are walking the streets in all but the futile search for work, for those who think there is no hope for the future, no recognition of their plight. The Catholic Church, though, has a social program. Is it not possible to be radical and not atheist? To protest, to expose, to complain, to point out abuses and demand reforms without desiring the overthrow of religion. But for Dorothy Day, and these photos follow her life. So when you're looking at each one of the photos, you'll see her as a young girl, you'll see her living in tenements, you'll see her in different activities as I go through, and there'll be several of these that I'll show throughout our time together. For Dorothy, May Day of 1933 and that first edition of the Catholic Worker only arrived after a long and circuitous journey. And I will say her backstory is really highly unusual, to say the least. And that's what we'll look at. Dorothy Day was born November 8th, 1897 in Brooklyn, New York. And in 1904, her parents, her father was a racetrack newspaper reporter, took the young family to San Francisco. But 2 years later, the big San Francisco earthquake put John out of work. And so he moved the family to Chicago. And in Chicago, John was hard pressed to find any kind of work. And so the family had to move into a dingy six-room, three-story tenement located in the middle of a lot of concrete. And this experience of poverty and the lack of being able to see nature was really depressing as to Dorothy. An Episcopal priest visited their home and invited the family to come to church. And her non-church-going parents declined the invitation, but said the kids can go if they want to. And Dorothy really liked the music and the prayers and the collects and the psalms and the Te Deum. And she often hummed to herself, "All the works of the Lord, praise and glorify him forever." Of her minimal childhood church experiences, she reflected in later years, "I always felt the common unity of all humanity. The longing of the human heart is for communion." Once her father found a reporting job, he was able to move the family to happier quarters. And Dorothy, as you can see in one of the photos, was always an avid reader. In her last year in high school, she leaned more and more into her radical tendencies. Her brother Donald's newspaper reporting on the harsh working conditions in factories touched her, as did the writings of Upton Sinclair and Jack London and the Russian writers, which led her to Dostoevsky and to Tolstoy. Dorothy also at this time started taking long walks into Chicago's West Side. where she explored the slums and the slaughterhouses. To her surprise, she also found communities that were rich in traditions and very special foods. It was here that she first awoke to her call in her heart to have her life somehow linked up with the poor. But how this realization was going to come to fruition would take a long time in coming. During her university studies at the University of Illinois, the more she read and the more she observed those living on the margins, the greater became her bewilderment at why more was not being done to alleviate social disparities in the world. She said, "A long procession of desperate people called to me. Where were the saints trying to change the social order?" This challenge eventually became her vocation. Today, Pope Francis would call this the globalization of indifference. While at the U of I, Dorothy joined the Socialist Party, found her heroes in those who were building unions and cooperatives, and she joined the Writers Club. But 2 years of university was just about enough for Dorothy. At 18, she went to New York City and she pounded the pavement trying to find a reporting job, which was very difficult for women in that day and age. At the Socialist Daily, The Call, she finally convinced the editor, who said, "I don't have any money to pay you," convinced him that he should give her $5 a week so that she could write stories on how it was to live in the city on $5 a week. So once the stories were finished, the editor liked her work and he said he would hire her and try to find her $12 a week. She found community though in the staff, and especially in their late night gatherings, sometimes until dawn, in a neighborhood restaurant where they debated differing radical ideologies. One friend, Jack Gold, who shared Dorothy's passion for the poor, later became the editor of the communist paper, The Daily Worker, that I think we're all familiar with. Ideologically, Dorothy, though, remained a socialist. Her $5 a month, vermin-infested, drafty, noise-filled Cherry Street tenement apartment still pleased her, though, because of the multicultural variety that was there and its vibrancy. Dorothy, though, felt that the pace of a daily newspaper was really hard for her. It gave her little time for reflection. And always Dorothy was a person who had an interior life that that she was nurturing, but felt like she didn't, you know, she never had the time to live it out intellectually and spiritually as she needed to. So she joined the magazine, The Masses, which drew the elite of the left in the US at that time, Max Eastman and Jack Reed, for example. And they were, that magazine was closely watched by the US Post Office. And in 1917, the Post Office rescinded its mailing permit. So Dorothy was out of work. And she joined her friend Peggy Baird and 40 other women in a suffragist voting rights protest in Lafayette Park across from the White House, which are the bottom first two pictures in the on the screen. On the first attempt, arrests were made, but no jail time was made. And so the women returned to the White House, repeated their action, and again they were arrested. But this time they were put into the Occoquan penal workhouse for 30 days. And this time was really devastating to Dorothy herself. But the women determined to fast until they were granted to be treated not as criminals, but as political prisoners who would have certain rights there. It was transformative for Dorothy, who went into a deep depression during that time, but she felt more and more an identification with the many poor people who most people view in horror and really feel no identity with at all. And Dorothy asked, while she was in prison, this was the first of her many incarcerations, by the way, and she turned to the Psalms when she asked for a Bible and read, "They that sow in tears shall reap in joy." And for her, she decided that she wanted to make her protest and casting the seeds that she would sow to be against brutality and injustice. After their release by a presidential pardon by Wilson, Dorothy went out from the first of many incarcerations to come. Back in New York City, she wrote again for the Liberator magazine and joined friends, including Eugene O'Neill, hanging out and drinking and talking frequently until dawn in Greenwich Village. Eugene O'Neill, who was haunted like Dorothy repeated to her the poem of the Hound of Heaven, which she said brought me such a consciousness of God. That poem goes, "I fled him down the nights and down the days. I fled him down the arches of the years. I fled him down the labyrinthine ways of my own mind." It was O'Neill, when Dorothy started going into churches, after putting a drunk O'Neill to bed at night and attended early morning masses. And she saw ordinary working people in these Catholic churches, which sort of helped her along, because she always saw the Catholic Church as a rich church and a hierarchical church and wanted to steer away from it. Dorothy and her sister Della, though, decided at this time to become wartime nurses at King's Hospital during the 1918 influenza season. And that's the last photo up there on the screen. Here she met and fell in love with and moved in with Lionel Moshe, who was an orderly and had been a reporter with the Kansas City Star. He was totally opposed to marriage, and he was jealous and extremely possessive. And when he became jealous of her friendship with Jack Gold, he stomped out and left her. And a devastated Dorothy at that time tried to commit suicide. The affair resumed, however, and Dorothy became pregnant. And with this pregnancy, Lionel insisted that she get an abortion. And so he promised that he would be there for her when she returned after the procedure. But she went back to their apartment, which was totally empty of Moisey, except for a note that he left her saying, "Forget me," and a little bit of money that he had. After a very brief marriage, then she fell in love with someone else and married for a very brief time. She went back to Chicago and resumed her affair with Moisey and also with the Liberator magazine itself. She began also at that time to have a better conception of the Catholic Church itself. She began to see it as a church of immigrants and of the masses of the poor. And at the same time, she began to see more and more clearly the need for deep social change as she witnessed the exploitation of those immigrants in sweatshops and in the stockyards of Chicago. Neither the job nor her relationship with Moisey lasted, but she had saved up enough money that she was able to buy a little fisherman's cottage with a tin roof on Staten Island. So she moved back to New York and was able to write in her cottage there. Her friend Peggy Baird, the one that she had been protesting in front of the White House with, introduced her to this wonderful man in her life, Forrester Batterham. And he was a gentle and shy anarchist, a biologist, an avid reader, who nonetheless disapprove both of marriage and religion. You know, Dorothy just keeps getting mixed up with these men that are not right for her in any way, shape, or form. But still, he was very kind, Forster was. And they fell deeply in love. And these top two pictures are Forster and Dorothy. At this time, Dorothy embarked probably on four of the happiest years of her life, a time of love for Forster and her life on Staten Island, and for motherhood and conversion. She admired in both Forster and her neighbor Lefty living examples of William James's reflection, "The praises of poverty need once more to be boldly sung, the liberation from material attachments, the unbribed soul." In other words, a willingness to live a life of voluntary poverty. She was deeply pained that Forster was so against marriage, for she loved him in every way. And at the same time, Dorothy knew a deeper sense of God's reality and immanence, especially revealed to her through the beauty of creation that we sang so beautifully there, or recited so beautifully this morning, and the beauty of the love that she and Forster really shared. She often quoted Dostoevsky at this time, "The world will be saved by beauty." And in 1925, Dorothy learned again that she was pregnant, and she was absolutely ecstatic because she really thought that she was sterile because of her abortion. And she found herself frequently singing the Te Deum. In an old book that she found a note that she had once written, and she said, "Life would be utterly unbearable if we thought we were going nowhere, that we had nothing to look forward to. The greatest gift life can offer would be faith in God and in a hereafter." On March 4th, 1926, Tamar Teresa was born, and Dorothy, with absolute joy, entrusted this little girl to Mary, and determined that she would have the girl baptized and not have her flounder like she had done for so many years in her life. And Dorothy found that her leanings toward the Catholic Church grew, just as she knew that Forster and her friends regarded it as an institution that blessed injustices and practiced repression. For Dorothy, reflecting in later years, she said, "Certainly I knew when I became a Catholic that the church was a human institution, and at first I had a sense of my betrayal of the working class, of the poor and the oppressed. But just as I in my youth sought them out and lived in their slums and felt at home, so the Lord was seeking me out, and I could not resist him. And I found him in the church, in the sacraments, life-giving and life-strengthening, in spite of the boring sermons, the incomprehensible and mumbled Latin, the Sunday Catholic, the wide gulf between clergy and laity, even the clergy's contempt for the laity." She was puzzled why some Christians called people Marxist when they go beyond feeding the hungry to ask why people are hungry to begin with. Dorothy had grown to believe that it was necessary to challenge, to protest, to resist the social structures that cause such poverty and the need for such charity. While Dorothy had Tamar baptized, she did not get baptized herself and continued on living with Forster. Arguments between them, though, ensued, and it finally came to an ultimate blow-up. When Forster stormed out, Dorothy, brokenhearted, determined not to let him in when he returned, and she immediately made an appointment with a local priest to be received into the Catholic Church. Of that day, Dorothy recalled, "I had no sense of peace, no joy, no conviction that what I was doing was right. It was just something I had to do. She felt deeply that she was betraying the poor and her commitment to social justice. I think that Dorothy's deep love for Forrester, though, remained with her throughout her life. But she was called in a very different direction. In a quandary, she spent the next 5 years searching for ways to support herself and Tamar through work that linked her religious faith, her commitment to social justice, and her vocation as a writer. And it was while covering the 1932 Hunger March in November that brought Dorothy clarity. She did not like the way that the newspaper reporters were reporting this, because they were reporting it as an event of a communist menace and violence that had called out, and this is familiar to our own day, I think, many of what's going on, the heavily weaponized National Guard and the 6th Marine Reserve that set up barricades. And Dorothy thought to herself, how our dear Lord must love them. They were his friends, his comrades, and who knows how close to his heart in their attempt to work for justice. Once the barricades were removed from the marchers, the federal court had voted in favor of the marchers. And so on December 8th, Dorothy went to the crypt of the Shrine of the Immaculate Conception, which was being built at that time near Catholic U in DC. And she said, there I offered up a special prayer, a prayer which came with tears and anguish that some way would open up for me to use what talents I had for my fellow workers and for the poor. And lo and behold, when she returned to her apartment in New York the next day on December 9th, a disheveled stranger with calloused hands and a thick French accent was there. He introduced himself as Peter Morin, which is in that second picture, and said two people who knew both he and Dorothy had said for him to come to her because they both thought alike. Gentle Peter had been a Christian brother, a laborer, a fallen away Catholic, and a fine teacher who envisioned a new social order in which he said it would be easier for men to be good. Peter inspired her then to start a newspaper to promote the vision of the social vision of the gospel and houses of hospitality where the works of mercy were put into practice. In other words, a way of living out the radical implications of love of God and neighbor. Trusting Peter's dictum, God sends you what you need, Dorothy's kitchen table became the editorial office for the first edition of the Catholic Worker. So that first edition that I talked about earlier reached its first readers for a penny a copy in Union Square on May Day, 1933. When Dorothy's brother and his family moved from Dorothy's apartment, Peter and two other men moved in. So Dorothy's apartment on 15th Street became the first Catholic Worker house of hospitality. And the need grew. Even by December 11th, a young woman came to the apartment and said that she needed hospitality, the kind of hospitality that she had read about in the Catholic Worker, because she and her friend had been living in the subway until her friend had thrown herself in front of a train. So that very afternoon, Dorothy went out and rented another apartment and named it the Teresa Joseph Cooperative. And houses of hospitality soon multiplied. Until today, there are some 240 Catholic Worker houses of hospitality around the United States and abroad. Communal farms came a few years later and served not only as farming communities, but also as places of prayerful retreat. All in the Catholic Worker movement are committed to nonviolence, voluntary poverty, prayer, and hospitality for the homeless, hungry, the exiled, and the forsaken. Staff and the guests live together in the houses of hospitality, and no one receives a salary. Nor did anyone, including Dorothy, for the 47 years that she lived as a Catholic worker. The Catholic worker is not only a movement, but it's also a way of life lived through a radical gospel lens that embraces Jesus's Sermon on the Mount and the works of mercy, hospitality, and justice, offered in self-giving love as its foundation. Now, we'll go back a number of centuries. St. Teresa of Lisieux's Little Way that influenced Dorothy influenced also the ambiance of the houses of hospitality. Now, Teresa of Lisieux is known as the Little Flower, was a French Carmelite nun who died at age 24. So who could be poles apart, you know, not only in time and space, but in way of the way that they had lived than Dorothy and Teresa of Lisieux. On first reading Teresa's Little Way, which consisted of performing all the small deeds and actions of our daily life in a spirit of love in the presence of God, Dorothy thought it all to be just a bunch of pious pap. But as Dorothy lived out her life in the Catholic worker movement, she came to understand that everyday ordinary life could be an arena for holiness, a place for sanctification. And each work of mercy might increase the balance of love in the world, she reflected. Her eyes opened to the relevance of Teresa's Little Way as she worked among the most vulnerable among us. She saw the social implications of Teresa's teachings, the significance of all the little things that we do every day. For Dorothy, this way of life signified the transformative meaning of Jesus's story of the loaves and the fishes, as well as the mustard seed's need to die and rise. In sum, she reflected, the greatest challenge of our day is this: how to bring about a revolution of the heart, a revolution that must begin with each one of us. What most impressed Dorothy was Teresa's certainty that nothing, even the most hidden action, was ever wasted. Paperwork, cleaning the house, dealing with innumerable visitors, answering the phone, keeping patients, acting intelligently, which is to find some meaning in all that happens. These things too are the works of peace and often seem like a very little way, she said. Nothing was wasted either in the many years of living amidst the sights and smells of poverty and squalor, of not knowing where your funds would come from to keep the lights on or buy the beans, eating poorly cooked food, or putting up with lice and bed bugs. Nothing was wasted either in their protests, in handing out leaflets, or in going to jail. For Dorothy, as it was for St. Therese, living in such a way was built on a foundation of a deep prayer life, a disciplined spiritual life. Ever hear that here at Epiphany? As Dorothy said, we try to shelter the homeless and give them clothes, but there is a strong faith at work. We pray. Without prayer and the sacraments, the Catholic worker would be blown away like dust in the wind, according to Dorothy. Dorothy saw the face of Jesus in the poor and believed all are called to be saints, saying, Christ remains with us not only through the Mass, but also in the distressing disguise of the poor. To live with the poor is a contemplative vocation, for it is to live in the constant presence of Jesus. Dorothy Day brought to the Catholic worker that she and Peter Morin founded all that she was and all that she became. As her life unfolded and the decades came and went, so too did Dorothy's growth in love and compassion come. In her life before the Catholic worker, she was a protester against societal injustices and for human rights and human dignity. Starting during her IWW membership days and on through the breadlines and the evictions and the bank closings and all the job losses of the Great Depression. And she carried through in the philosophy of nonviolence of the civil rights movement. And through a gospel lens, she was actively vocal and vehemently anti-war through both world wars and Vietnam. Of war, Dorothy insisted, the works of mercy are the polar opposites of the works of war. Dorothy and Peter, who was born into a French peasant family, had long championed justice for farm workers. Her last of multiple incarcerations occurred as she was protesting in 1976 with Cesar Chavez, the middle photo, and the United Farm Workers during the time of the Great Boycotts. Of her many incarcerations, Dorothy reminded those around her, "We grow by pruning and it hurts." Dorothy Day died as she had lived. She started her day on November 29th, 1980 with prayer. Her telephone conversation with a friend, Eileen Egan, was about what was being done for survivors of a strong earthquake in southern Italy. She had a cup of tea with her daughter, Tamar, who had blessed her, you'll see them here in the picture, with 9 grandchildren and several great-grandchildren. The two held hands, and at 5:30 p.m., she died quietly, as quiet as the turning of a page, someone wrote. And the photo here is of Tamar and Forrester at her memorial service, and then the procession coming down at that memorial service. Dorothy's 1952 autobiography, The Long Loneliness, concludes with a postscript that I think is well worth for our closing reflection. "We were just sitting there talking when Peter Morin came in. We were just sitting there talking when lines of people began to form saying, 'We need bread.' We could not say, 'Go be thou filled.' If there were 6 small loaves and a few fishes, we had to divide them. There was always bread. We were just sitting there talking and people moved in on us and somehow the walls expanded. We were just sitting there talking and someone said, 'Let's all go live on a farm.' It was as casual as all of that. It just came about. It just happened. I found myself a barren woman, the joyful mother of children. It is not always easy to be joyful, to keep in mind the duty of delight. The most significant thing about the Catholic worker is poverty, some say. The most significant thing is community, others say. But the final word is love. At times it has been, in the words of Father Zosimus, a harsh and dreadful thing. And our very faith in love has been tried through fire. We cannot love God unless we love each other. And to love, we must know each other. We know him in the breaking of the bread. And we know each other in the breaking of the bread. Heaven is a banquet, and life is a banquet too, with a crust where there is companionship. It all happened while we sat there talking, and it is still going on." And so, I wonder if you have some questions or observations. And I do have a couple of discussion questions that we can share together. Therese.
I know one thing that you said, I've seen this seen you present this before, and I loved it. And one thing that you said last time was that, I think it was Peter, was very staunchly against the church, but then he went to her funeral for her, which was kind of a big deal because he was so against the church. But out of respect for her, he went.
He did. For those of you online, Therese said that when she heard me talking about Dorothy Day before, that he had been so opposed to religion, but he had gone to church at her funeral, and that really touched Therese or really impressed her. And I think that, you know, Dorothy and Forrester really did have a love for one another. And of course, he was Tamar's father. And so it was father and daughter that were sitting there at the funeral together. But it was Dorothy that he was remembering, and all those years later, because when you think of how long it was between the time that they separated and the time that she died, it was many, many years. Because of Tamar, because of having a child together, that there was always, you know, that time that they did stay together, or not stay together, but kept in touch with one another. And I think that probably, as she continued to love him, I think that he probably saw in her things that he admired too, and that he admired the way that she lived her life. Sometimes, you know, opposites come together and attract. Yes.
You expand on what you mean by justice.
I think that justice, it means many, many things, and it will mean thing different. What he and the question was, what do I mean by justice? And I think that justice is acting in a godly way towards one another. It's relational, I think. And it is acting in a way where you look at the human dignity of others, or you look at the goodness of creation. You look at and you try to give to other people what do unto others what you would have done unto you. In other words, the golden rule, in a certain sense, is also justice. So living in a just way is I think some of what Dwight talked about in the sermon this morning, as far as relationship was concerned, and seeing the best are the things that you do outside of the good and outside of, say, the rule of law. I mean, we live the rule of law and everything, but it's the way that it's the best way that we live our life, as would come out of the sermon this morning. What do you see?
No, I asked a question out of innocence.
Anybody else have something to add to that? Therese?
Oh, I have one more question. You said that she originally rented an apartment that became the first house of hospitality, and that there are 240 of them now. Did the church end up buying those properties? Do they own those properties? It sounds like she just rented something, but did that turn into a...
No, they bought... There's a lot of places where the Catholic Worker itself, through donations that people give and through the penny a copy for the Catholic Worker, which still today is sold for a penny a copy, you know, would bring in. But just to remind... The question was, by Therese, was, again, how did they manage to get the houses of hospitality, the 240 that are, you know, around the world, in our country and around the world today? And they're generally in the old places, the older homes and places like that, but sometimes they're donated, sometimes they're, you know, that they're bought in some way or in some way or another. But it always was, you know, where is that next penny going to come from so that we can keep the lights on, so that we can feed the people? And the bread lines, you know, form every morning. I forgot to point out in one of the pictures the bread lines that were there, but the bread lines are there for the soup and the bread every single morning. Excuse me. Are there every single morning for the people that are there, and nobody takes a salary that's there. My publisher, Robert Ellsberg, who is the son of Daniel Ellsberg, Robert, and he's the publisher of Orbis Books, which is based at Mary Knoll in New York, but is and has wonderful, wonderful books on social justice issues. That come out all the time. But anyway, Robert, after his sophomore year at Harvard, Jewish growing up, thought, I don't know where I'm going. You know, I have no idea what my life is. And so he dropped out and he went to the Catholic Worker, and he was gonna stay there a few months, and he stayed for 5 years in the very last years of Dorothy's life. And so, Dorothy put him as editor of the Catholic Worker, you know, during that time, which he knew nothing about at that point. I think he was majoring in English literature and that kind of, you know, the humanities, but he didn't know anything. And that helped me learn my vocation. My vocation wasn't to continue to be a Catholic Worker, but to go on and be a publisher, you know, that he has been for, I guess, 30 years, Robert's been up there at that. And he also has edited most of Dorothy Day's works, you know, her letters and different things, and her holdings, her archives are at Marquette University, where I taught. And but Robert is so, I mean, she transformed his life. And I think that the workers, the people who went there to volunteer, you know, all of their lives were transformed because of, and some of them stayed for a few weeks, some stayed for a few months, and like Robert stayed for 5 years, you know, or so. It's not a place where you have a salary or anything like that, and you just eat what's there, and you sleep there, and you hope that you have a bed that night, and if you don't, you sleep on the floor, and you know, so it's quite a place. Any other? I guess we didn't get to the discussion questions, did we? Because it's almost time for church, but for all of you, but she's really, she's an incredible woman, and if, you know, read The Long Loneliness at some time, and then look for, you know, like, as I said, Robert has put out The Duty of Delight is a lot of her diaries and letters that Robert has edited, and so pick her up and read her, because I think that there's a lot that's going on in our world today that really couples with what Dorothy aimed to do. And so she really aimed not only to help those at this time, like we're going to help an Afghan family. I mean, you look at all the outreach here at Epiphany that people can do, and getting involved in the outreach, the feeding of people, and all of that, but there's also the changing of social structures, the structural changes, and look at what we're doing as far as the racial studies that we're, you know, the racial studies that we're doing right now here at the church and all of that. So there's just a lot going on here at Epiphany that people can really involve themselves in too, which I think most of you are totally involved in already, so I don't need to preaching to the choir, I guess, aren't I? And so anyway, thank you very much.